Hey, let's pray. God, thank you so much for what you've done. Thank you for this place. Thank you for these people. God, the people gathered in this room, people watching online. I'm so thankful for this church. We love you. God, speak through me in the next few minutes. Move in our hearts today. We pray this in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Welcome to First Christian. So glad you guys braved the cold and the snow to be here this morning. Extra special thanks to all the Bengals fans who didn't sleep last night because you've never experienced anything like this in your life before. And I know it's just hard to wind down from that, isn't it? I mean, I'm a Browns fan, so I don't know personally what it's like, but I can imagine what it would be like, and so we're glad that you're here too. And our condolences for what's going to happen to you next week, because, man, look out. All right. If you have a Bible, Acts chapter 2, that's where we're going to be for a little bit this morning. Acts chapter 2. We have been, for a few weeks now, taking a look together at what healthy, Christ-centered community looks like. And specifically, we're talking about the difference it can make in our lives when we taste it. The difference that healthy, Christ-centered community makes in our lives when we experience it and when we feel it, when we're a part of it. And today we're going to continue that by looking at a picture of the very first church that we see here in the first few chapters of Acts. And this is important because we try to pattern ourselves here at First Christian after this church. We're what you might call a restoration movement church. It's the closest thing we have. We're not a denominational church. We don't have any outside like affiliations necessarily. We're independent as a church. But if you were going to get close to associating with anything, it would be the restoration movement. And simply put, that just means we're part of a whole bunch of churches who said, you know what? We want to do our best to do what we see written in these pages. We want to follow Jesus. We want to follow God's leading. We want to follow the Spirit's prompting. We're going to be about that and nothing else. And that's what we want to do as a church. And so we're going to take a look today at the early church, and that's what they did, that's what they were about, so that we can have maybe a little better idea, a little clearer picture of what we should strive to be as a church. Now, way back in the book of Acts, like in the early days of the church, it started as a movement. It wasn't a place, it wasn't a service, it wasn't a ministry or a program. It was a movement of people who caught fire. They were energized by what Jesus had done, and they were sent out on mission to make as many disciples as they could make by telling people who Jesus was and what he had done and what he wanted to do. Now, over the years, over the centuries, over almost 2,000 years, our definition of church has changed a bit from what happened in those early days. And you can even see it reflected in some of the words that we use. For example, just the word church comes from a German word. The word is Kirche. And that word means an assembly or a gathering or a place. But when you look at the New Testament, you go back to the original language that it was written in, and you see this Greek word, ekklesia. It means called out. It means movement. It indicates a group of people who, again, they were sent out on a mission. And so we've gone from using words like that to using words like church. And I know that's just what it means in our culture, but you can even see how things have shifted kind of in the terms that we use. But the original church here in the first few chapters of Acts, they were people gathered together on a mission. And when you look at this and you ask, you know, well, what came first, the mission or the church? I heard it put this way one time, and I love this, so I want to share this with you. God doesn't have a mission for his church. He created a church for his mission. Isn't that cool? God doesn't have a mission for his church. He created the church for his mission. That's what we're here for, which means that a church that's not on mission is not really a church. And even more, it means that Christians who aren't on mission aren't really part of the church. It's pretty strong words, right? Movements move, and if you're not moving, you're not part of the movement. Simply put. But when you're part of the movement, it sets your life on a trajectory that's so different, so unexpected from what you probably would have thought for yourself, that when you get to taste what Jesus wants to do in your life, it just changes the trajectory of your life, and it makes everything better, and it happens in Christ-centered biblical community. And so that's what we're looking at today. This picture of the church that we're going to look at is valuable because it's the opposite of a lot of what we see in the world around us. We live in a world that can create artificial, superficial communities. For example, social media is a powerful thing. It connects people in ways that a few years ago we would have never thought would be possible. Could you even imagine if COVID had happened 20 years ago and we couldn't live stream and we couldn't be connected on social media, we couldn't do church online? I mean, it allowed us as a church to stay connected literally as a pandemic swept across the globe, and we had to be in isolation from each other for a little while. It's a powerful thing, but it's a dangerous thing. It's dangerous because it allows us to put this image out that we just want everybody to see, like, okay, we just came through Christmas time and this is what gets me every year, all right? How many of you saw a picture of some family out at a Christmas tree farm picking out the perfect Christmas tree and everybody smiling? Everybody see one of those this Christmas? Let me tell you something, that was a lie. Because before that picture, there were 19 more pictures. And in every one of those pictures, there's a kid who's crying, some kid threw a snowball in the other kid's face, a kid picked up the saw he wasn't supposed to, now his hand's bleeding, and so in the picture where he's smiling, it's like behind his back, and they've got it all bandaged up, and they're like, smile, so he smiles, and then we'll go to the doctor, right? They're fighting with each other, arguing over what the perfect Christmas tree is, but the only picture you see is the one where everybody's smiling, they got this nice tree behind them. That's what social media does. It lets us put this image out that everything is good, everything is perfect in our families, and it removes kind of that authenticity from our relationships, and it can create a superficial community. There's a comedian that I love named Bo Burnham, and he's got this special on Netflix called Make Happy, and in that, he's kind of talking about social media, and he describes it this way, and I love this, by the way, this particular stand-up routine, because it's like one of the ones that makes me laugh, but also makes me kind of want to cry because he's so honest about some things. So listen to how he describes social media, because I think this is like a gut punch. He says it's the market's answer to a generation that has been demanded to perform. And so the market said, here, perform everything to each other all the time for no reason. And we feel this need to perform, don't we? When we perform for others, instead of letting them actually get to know us, we can't have real community. And unfortunately, that same dynamic can exist in the church at times. We tell ourselves that things like church attendance are what it's all about, but let me be honest with you, church attendance can be a performance. If you're not in Christ-centered community, and if you're not engaged with the church, attendance can be a performance. It can be a lot like social media. You show your face and you think you're good, but there's more to it than that. We're meant for more than that. You know what superficial community does to us? I mean, it makes us lonely. It makes us lonely because it we fool ourselves into thinking that it's the real deal, and then we never make ourselves experience like actual community, and it makes us lonely. It makes us isolated. It makes us just feel disconnected, and man, honestly, it makes us kind of lazy because we get used to it. I mean, let's be honest, how many of you in the room, like during COVID, you got kind of used to doing church on the couch on Sunday morning, right? You don't even have to put pants on for church anymore. And so the first time you thought, we should probably go back to church, that was kind of tough, wasn't it? Like, it makes us lazy, guys. And so we have to be really careful of that. It can be cheapened community at best, and it can be sinful at worst. And let me tell you, it doesn't matter if you have 100,000 followers if you don't have any friends. And it's not community at all. It's a cheap substitute. And we're made for more than that. But on the flip side, we see that the early church here in Acts, they were connected to each other. It wasn't just about going to church on Sunday. It was all the time. It was through the week. They lived life together. They broke bread together. They took care of each other. And we're going to see that as we look at Acts chapter 2. So if you don't have that open, go ahead and open it. Let me give you a little bit of context from Acts chapter 1. Here's what's just happened in this chapter, okay? For the very first time, the gospel has been preached. So it's the Feast of Pentecost. It's a big deal in the Jewish religion. You have these people from all corners of the world who are gathered together here in the city, and they speak different languages. And that's an important thing because you have all these people, they don't understand each other, but then you have this group of apostles, these followers of Jesus who have this gospel message, this good news of Jesus, and they want to tell everybody, all these people gathered in the city, they want to tell them who Jesus is and what he's done and what he wants to do for them, but they don't know how to talk to them. And so for the very first time, we see the Holy Spirit show up. And the Holy Spirit gives these men the ability to speak to all these people in the languages that they understand. Now, this is freaky, okay? Imagine if your head popped off the pillow this morning and you started speaking Italian. You've never spoken Italian before. You'd be like, think it's like a movie plot, right? It's weird. In fact, it was so weird that as people in the city, they saw these men. These aren't educated men. They're rough guys. These are guys who are like, they're tradesmen and they're fishermen. They're like factory workers. These aren't guys who have like doctorates in foreign languages and stuff like that. And everybody knew it. And so all these people who saw these guys all of a sudden start speaking all these different languages, you know what they said? They're hammered. They're drunk. Listen to them. They're just babbling on, right? They said they're drunk, but that's not at all what was happening. What happened was the Holy Spirit gave these men the ability to communicate the good news of Jesus to people in words that they would understand. Now, check this out. All those people from all these corners of the world are gathered in this place at this time for this purpose. They were not there on accident. And I want to tell you something. I will never, ever, ever believe that when you walk through these doors on a Sunday morning that you're here by accident. Every time you walk through these doors on a Sunday morning, I believe that God brought you here because there's something that he wants to say to you. He wants you to interact with somebody in the lobby who's going to encourage you. Or he wants you to come in here and listen to somebody teach who's going to say something that's going to inspire you. Or he wants you to come in here and sing some songs to Jesus that are going to move you. But I never believe it's on accident. I always believe it's on purpose. And similarly, these followers of Jesus are speaking to all these people who are gathered here in the city for this purpose at this time, right? It is not an accident. And one of the coolest things that happens is as they share the good news of Jesus, these people start to hear it and they start to say, oh yeah, Jesus, this sounds amazing. Like, I want to be a part of this. And it says in the book of Acts that 3,000 people in one day joined the church. 3,000 people. Let me tell you why that number is so cool. I love this. If you go all the way back to the Old Testament book of Exodus, what happens in this book, you see Moses leads God's people out of captivity in Egypt. They're wandering around in the wilderness for a long, long time. And eventually, things get chaotic. They don't know how to function as a society. They're all fighting with each other, and nobody knows what to do. And so God says, Moses, I need to give you like some order because you guys are a mess. And so he says, Moses, come on up on the mountain, and I'm gonna give you some rules and some guidelines and the law to help you live. And so Moses goes up on Mount Sinai and he meets with God and God gives him the Ten Commandments and God says, hey, go tell the people, this is my law and if you break it, you'll die. That's how serious the law was. And so here's where I'm going with this. Moses takes the law to the people and he gives it to him and he says, if you break it, you'll die. But still, a whole bunch of people broke it. Guess how many? Scripture says 3,000. People broke God's law and died. They lost their lives. And now in the book of Acts, we see the Holy Spirit show up and 3,000 people come to life. And you want to know why I think that's significant? It's significant because it's a reaffirmation that Jesus died to pay the penalty for our sin and for the times when we have broken God's law, where we have messed it up. Jesus died for that. But you know what? Where the Holy Spirit shows up, there's life. That's why that's such a powerful thing, even in that little number. And so 3,000 people join the church and they begin this movement to go and to spread the gospel all over the world. And I love this picture we're about to see in Acts chapter 2 of the kind of community they were. Check this out. We'll read it together, okay? Acts chapter 2, follow along with me. It says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. And everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together. And they had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. And every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. So the Holy Spirit moves these people. And as a result, they decided to devote themselves to a few things. Four specifically in this passage, it says they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. That's what their community looked like, okay? And it says they devoted themselves, and that is such a critical word in this passage because these weren't things that they just did casually when they thought about it. These weren't things that, you know, maybe they'd wake up one weekend and they'd say, I don't feel like it. But the next weekend they wake up and say, yeah, maybe this weekend. And so they show up. Like, actually what it says is, these things became obsessions for these new Christians. They were obsessed. They said, nothing is going to get in the way of me and this connection with God's people in this community and these steps I'm taking in my faith. They were devoted to them. They gave themselves to these things. That's what happens when the Holy Spirit moves. Now, sociologists will tell us we have a non-devoted society. In other words, what they'll tell us is as a culture, we have commitment issues, okay? And I don't think they're wrong. We as a culture, we can have some problems following through on some things. We have problems committing. True devotion is an endangered thing in our society. But Scripture makes it clear that we're called to be devoted to helping to create a Christ-centered community within the church. So there are a few things I want to pull out of this passage because I think they help define what that kind of community can look like. And as we as a church here at First Christian continue to strive to be that kind of community, it's important to have a clear picture of what it ought to be like. So we're going to look at five things really quickly this morning that help to define the kind of community we want to be as a church. So number one, healthy community is for all people. You hear us say things like that around here all the time. It's for all people. But here's how we know that. Acts chapter 1, verse 14 makes it clear that both men and women were a part of the early church. And that's significant because back in this day, women didn't always get a lot of attention. It was always like, okay, we're going to head count, but we're going to count the men. Or, you know, we're going to invite people to the meeting, but we're going to invite the men or whatever. And the men get talked about or the men get included, but the women kind of got ignored or left out, or at least nobody counted them or paid attention to them. And this verse makes it clear it was men and women. Why is that significant? Because this community was for everyone. Okay, Acts chapter 6 tells us Greek Jews were included. That's significant because the Greek Jews and some other groups of Jews didn't get along with each other. And so that verse makes it clear, this isn't just for one group, it's for everybody. Acts chapters 10 and 11 tell us that non-Jews were included. We know them as Gentiles. Basically, everybody who's not a Jew is a Gentile in the book of Acts, and they were included in this community. So it's not just for these Jews who've been God's people for centuries and centuries, but now anybody can be a part of it. Your background, your race and ethnicity, your economic or social status, your gender, none of those things disqualified you from being a part of God's community. And listen, here at First Christian Church, none of those things disqualify you from being part of our community either. This is a place where Jesus is for all people. And we say it this way, that nothing in your life, nothing in your background, nothing in your past, nothing that's going on disqualifies you from God working in your life, from him bringing you to him, leading you to Jesus, and starting to work in your life. But let me tell you, he's got a better plan than your plan. And so whatever's going on in your life, he wants to do something powerful to make things better for you. He wants to change you from the inside out, but you're never disqualified because of some condition in your life. That's the kind of community we want to be. That's a healthy community, and that's what we see in the book of Acts. So number one, healthy community is for all people. Number two, healthy community is centered around the gospel. It's centered around the gospel. There's a New York Times article I read recently. This psychologist was lamenting or complaining or something. He's explaining that he's saddened by the fact that he sees this particular change in our culture. And I want to read you what he said. This is the way he put it. He said, "Fewer and fewer people today come in to my office saying, I want to change. What I see more and more is people want someone else to change. So my pitch went from, I treat people with depression and anxiety to, are you having trouble with difficult people in your life? I don't have a problem, you have a problem." Right? A lot of people have that posture these days. And we say things like this. You'll hear people say things like, it's just my truth. Or it's just your truth. It's his truth. It's her truth. Listen, that's ridiculous. There's one truth. It's not mine. It's not yours. It's Jesus' truth. There is no other truth. Okay? And the people in this early church, they knew that. They knew that. Listen, for them, like, they would look at the world around them, and it's like the sky was falling, okay? They're following Jesus. They're doing what they feel like they're supposed to do, but that was not well received in that culture. So a lot of them were fired from their jobs because their employers didn't want to have these Christians working for them. You can't work for me on the Sabbath now because you follow Jesus, whatever. Like, I don't need you to work for me then, or I want nothing to do with you. They would lose their jobs. They had trouble putting food on their tables. They had trouble keeping a roof over their family's heads. Many of them were persecuted. They were mocked. They were thrown out of their communities or out of their cities. They would lose their homes entirely. Many of them lost their lives. And they understood that every single day as their physical lives were being threatened, that their only hope was if their faith was anchored in Jesus. And the way that that would happen, again, as Romans says, is if they were transformed by the renewing of their minds, if they were transformed from the inside out by the Holy Spirit. And so they said it starts with, we have to understand more about who God is and what he has to say. And so they started showing up to church and listening and having people teach it to them. And they'd bring their kids along and they'd have people like Brian teach it to their kids, or Leah teach it to their kids. Or they'd get in a, check this out. This is kind of cool. They had small groups Acts says they met in the temple courts, but it also says they met daily for breaking of bread. So they had like big services, and then they had small groups. They would get together, and they would soak it in any way that they could because they understood the significance of that. And let me tell you, there's no way around it for you and me. If you want to be a growing follower of Jesus, you have to be a learner. You have to be. It's not enough to feel stuff. That's important, but you have to be a learner. Most of the growing Christians I know are readers. Now, that's tough for me because I'm not a very good reader. I have to work hard to make it through a book, okay? I can make it through Sports Illustrated easy, but I got to work hard to make it through a book. So maybe you're like me. Maybe reading's tough. Do audiobooks. Talk to people who read. If sitting down and reading the Bible is tough for you, then listen to the audio Bible. Listen, in your pocket, if you have one of these, you have a Bible. And there's a built-in audio Bible in it. So flip that thing on when you're driving in your car and soak in God's word. Take it in with you, okay? Be a reader. Be a learner. Listen to podcasts. Listen to sermons. We podcast our sermons every single week. If you miss one or you want to go back and listen again, you can subscribe and you can listen every single week. Subscribe to those things. Again, talk to people who read. Talk to people who are growing. Get a daily Bible reading plan. I've got a group of people we put together. There's about 65 or 70 of us in this group, and we're reading through the Bible together in the Bible app this year as a group. If you want to get in on that, come and tell me, and I'll get you in on it. But find some people and get into the Word with them. This is the first time I'll say this, and I'll say it several times today. Get in a small group. You need to be in one. Get in a life group. Get people around you who are going to be there for you and support you and have your back. Whatever it takes, be a learner. Because growing Christians are people who are learning. They're soaking in the truth of God. And it's because healthy community is centered on it. It's centered on the gospel. Number three, healthy community is a refuge. It's a refuge. I love the kind of picture we get here in verse 45 where it says that these early Christians loved each other so much that if they found out somebody had a need, they'd start selling their stuff to help them out. It's like, oh, you got bills you can't pay? Okay, I got some furniture I can sell. Oh, you have a big need? Okay, I'll sell my house. It says it right on the page. They sold their property, right? I'll sell my land. Whatever it takes, I'm going to take care of you. That was their attitude toward each other. It was a refuge. If somebody needed help, they didn't go get in line at some government agency. They went to church. Man, church, let me tell you, if we got it right, that's how it would be. That's how it would be. That's the kind of community we should be for each other because we're family. I know there's people, if you're sitting here in the room, you're looking across the room, there's people you don't know, probably some people you've never seen before. If you're watching online, you're probably like, you don't even know who's in the room. They don't know you're watching, right? Well, let me tell you something. We're family. Doesn't mean we always get along. Doesn't mean everybody likes everybody. You all have that weird uncle in your family nobody wants to invite to Thanksgiving, right? But we're family, and we take care of each other. And this is how it ought to be, and I know that because in John chapter 13, Jesus said these words. He said, a new command I give you, love one another. Now listen to this. He says, as I have loved you, so you must love one another. And I'm just curious, do you know how Jesus loved us? He died for us. So he says, as I've loved you, you should love one another. And then he says this, by this everyone will know that you are my disciples if you go to church. By this everyone will know you're my disciples if you wear a WWJD bracelet, if you have a Jesus for All People bumper sticker on your car, if you carry your Bible to your desk at work, if you only listen to Christian music. No. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples. If you what? Come on, somebody. If you love one another. If you love one another. Church isn't supposed to be a place where you come and you sit in a service and then you leave and go back to your life. This is a place where we have each other's backs. When we grow together. When we win together. When we move together because we're family. There's a verse in Galatians chapter 6 that says, carry each other's burdens, and in this way, you will fulfill the law of Christ. Let me tell you how this looked for my family a few years ago. I was a senior in high school. Some of you maybe heard me tell this story before, but it's the best example I can think of, so I'm going to tell it again. I'm a senior in high school, and I'm sitting at home one day doing some homework, and the phone rings, and I pick it up at the same time as my dad. For those of you who are like, teenagers, we used to have these things on the walls in our homes called telephones, and you can answer them at the same time as somebody else in another room. Just ask your parents later. They'll tell you about it. So I answer the phone at the same time as my dad, and I hear him pick up, and this voice on the other end of the phone says, "Who is this?" And I thought, that's weird. You called us. You should probably know who you're calling, right? But he told them, and they said, "Sir, I'm sorry to tell you this, but your son's been in an accident." So my younger brother, Mike, had mowed lawns and done odd jobs and stuff all summer to save up for this bike that he really wanted. And so he finally got it, and he took it out for a test drive that day, and he's riding down the road, kind of out in the country outside the town we lived in, and some guy on a motorcycle wasn't paying any attention to what he was doing, and he hit him at about 80 miles an hour in the back. It sent him flying like 30 or so feet through the air, and he landed in a ditch in somebody's front yard, and thank God that person happened to be out in their yard doing a little landscaping, and they heard the whole thing and turned and saw what was going on. And my brother happened to have, I honestly don't know how they got a hold of us. Must have had something on him or something. They were able to figure out who we were. But they took him to the hospital, life flighted him to Akron Children's. He was there for like 2 weeks, and for like the first week, they weren't even sure he was really going to make it. It was really bad. Here's why I tell you that story. In that 2 weeks, you know who showed up at the hospital to sit with my mom for hours in silence? It was the women from my parents' life group. You know who came and took care of our house while our family was just like scattered all over the place trying to figure things out? It was the guys from my parents' life group. You know who cooked meals so we didn't have to worry about where dinner was going to come from, like in the midst of all the chaos? People in my parents' life group. You know who was at our house when we brought my brother home with a brand new bicycle with a big red bow on it? It's my parents' life group. They were our lifeline in the hardest 2 weeks I have ever seen my parents go through. Now, I tell you that, guys, because Galatians 6:2 says, carry each other's burdens. And they did that for us. And it made all the difference. And I want you to have that in your life. When a tough time comes, you may not see it coming. It may hit you 80 miles an hour in the back. You need people around you who are going to hold your hand in that season. You need healthy, Christ-centered community because it's a refuge. It's where we care for each other because we're family. Now, let me just say this, and then we're going to move on. If you need help, I want you to come and talk to me. Or I want you to go to the hub after church. Or if you're online, I want you to go to firstchristian.com/care. And I can't promise we can fix everything, but we're going to try to help in whatever way we can, okay? So if you need help, start here because we're family, okay? Number four, healthy community is a daily thing. It's a daily thing. Again, it says they met in the temple courts, they did church together, they listened to the apostles teach, but then it says they also met in homes every day. So they had big church and they had small groups, and that's why we pattern ourselves that way. For them, it wasn't just about one day a week. So let me ask you this, who's got a kid in sports? Anybody in the room, kid in sports? Who's got a kid, maybe school play, maybe kid in band? Anybody have a kid in band? How many hours a week do your kids practice this stuff? You ever had a moment where it's midnight on a Wednesday and you think, if I have to listen to 5 more minutes of this trumpet, I'm going to die? Like you just can't handle the practicing anymore, right? Or it's like, if I have to drive my kid to 6 more like football practices, I might just drive off a bridge or something like that. You know what I mean? Hours and hours, like countless amounts of time that kids devote to and I played sports when I was, like I did it too. Like it's countless time. Or many of you, you've got a job that just takes hours and hours and hours a week. Or, you know, even throwaway time. Like you'll sit and you'll watch like a 2 or 3 hour football game, or maybe sometimes longer. You know, if you're a baseball fan, it's like 10 hours long, you know. You'll sit and you'll watch that. You don't even blink, or you'll binge some stupid Netflix show all day because Netflix only makes stupid shows anymore, but you'll watch it anyway, and you'll do it all day long, you know what I mean? And you don't even think about it because you're just doing it, right? Let me give you a number. 168. You know what that number is? It's how many hours you have in a week. That's 10,080 minutes. Let me tell you something. If out of 10,080 minutes, The only part of that that your soul is getting is 60 minutes at church on Sunday morning. Don't be surprised if God feels distant. Out of 168 hours in your week, if the only part of that that your soul is getting is 1 hour at church, then don't be surprised if when a tough time comes, the first thing that struggles is your faith and you don't know where to turn. Listen, if it takes like 16 hours a week for football practices or whatever, it's probably more than that now, you know, like if it takes that just to get good at football, man, what's it take to be a disciple of Jesus? You got to invest. And it's a daily thing. It's not a Sunday thing. It's a Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and on and on. It's a daily thing. You need to get into that community regularly. So let me encourage you to start with two things. Number one, make a commitment to be at church. I've heard this stat recently that any more regular church attendance is defined as 1 to 1.5 times per month. When I was a kid, if somebody at our church would have cracked the doors open at 3 a.m. on a Tuesday, my mom would have dragged me in. Right? That was regular for my family. And I'm not saying, I fought her tooth and nail every step of the way. I'm sure it's the last place I wanted to be. But man, that was regular church attendance when I was growing up. And for many of you, I know it was like that. Now they're saying it's like 1 to 1.5 times a month. And so now instead of out of 168 hours a week, God gets one. Now it's like maybe one out of, what would that be? Like, you know, 700 hours a week or something like that, or a month. Man, your soul can't survive that. So get into community, make a commitment to beat the trend. Make a commitment to be engaged and involved in the church and set a new bar. And the other thing I'd encourage you to do again is get in a life group. And let me just say, it's not only important that you're in one, it's important what happens in that group. Make sure that as a group, you're encouraging each other and praying for each other and breaking bread together and doing life together. Make sure you're studying the Word of God. Don't just read a few verses and share your feelings about it and move on, but get to know it, study the Word, right? That's what a group should do. So be in a group, and we're gonna talk about how you get in one here in a minute. Another opportunity you may not know we even have, but be a mentor or find a mentor. We have mentoring programs for men and women. So if you're like a new Christian and you wanna know what it means to follow Jesus, we got some people who've been doing this a little while who wanna walk with you. Or if you are that person and you've been doing this for a while, you should be mentoring somebody. So stop at the Hub today and tell Sean, hey, talk to me about mentoring. But get involved in that. Just don't miss opportunities to be involved in the life of the church. Don't miss those. It's a privilege that we get to do this thing. So be part of it. Last thing, healthy community is a movement. It's a movement. So we gotta move. We gotta move. If we're a healthy community, we should be making a difference, and we can't do it sitting still. So why do we do this? We do this really, honestly, simply put, because when we serve people, and when we move, when we share our faith, when we're evangelistic with our stories, when we do that, it opens doors for spiritual conversations with people, and we can tell them who Jesus is and what he means to us. That's why we serve, and so we do. We serve just like Jesus did. We do our best, we share our faith, and we pray that God's gonna take those efforts and multiply them so that people will know Jesus and lives will change. Now, I've just given you like 5 things from that passage that define healthy community, right? Healthy Christ-centered community. Let me ask you, what difference would it make in your life if you had that kind of community if you don't already? Imagine. And then let me tell you, that's exactly the kind of community that Jesus wants you to have in your life. He wants you to have all of those things. And there's one short verse in this passage that kind of sums it all up. It's verse 44. If you still have it in front of you, it says this. All the believers were together and had everything in common. In a word, they were united. They were united. Thousands of followers of Jesus, one mission. Everybody moving together. It sounds a lot better to me than the kind of community Bo Burnham described in that Netflix special, right? It's the real thing. Now, let me ask you, aren't you so glad that when you need this community, you know where to find it? Aren't you so glad you know that when you need that kind of community, you can come here and you can get it? Man, I am. I love this church. I'm thankful for this church because I know when I need this kind of community, I can get it here. Let me tell you something. We're going to land the plane with this, okay? Community is for you, and we've been talking a lot today about what that kind of community can do in your life. But it also depends on you. Healthy community is for you, but man, it's for others. And listen, you know you can come here and you can get this kind of community because when you show up here, there are some people, like I said earlier, who maybe bump into you in the lobby and encourage you, or they'll say something to inspire you, or they'll lead you in a next step or whatever. And so you know you can come here and you can get that community. But what happens if you show up here and nobody's here? You're on an island, I guess, is good luck, right? And so what happens if somebody else shows up here and they're like, man, I just need this community in my life, and they show up here, but you're the person they need and you're not there? What happens if they show up here and you're like the perfect, like God has put you in exactly the right position in your life to say something or do something or serve them or love them in a way that's gonna change everything for them, but you missed it because you missed it. You weren't engaged. Community depends on you and it's for others. It's all of us together so that when we need this place, when we need this community, man, we're there for each other. And just like Galatians says, we're ready to carry each other's burdens. That's what it takes. And let me tell you what the book of Acts tells me. It tells me that if we will be that kind of community, we're gonna grow every single day because there aren't many places like that in the world. There aren't many places to find that kind of support and that kind of encouragement and that kind of love and that kind of truth. It's not out there. And when people see it, they start to get real curious and they go, man, I want a little bit of that. Tell me where I can find it. And they start showing up. That's what happened for the early church in the book of Acts. And I promise you, it's what'll happen here too. If we will commit to be that kind of community for each other, then other people, they're gonna break down the doors because they wanna know where it's coming from. And so church, we gotta be that way. And let me tell you, when you bless somebody else, you get blessed. That's the coolest part of it. That's in God's economy, it's like you spend, you receive. That's how he set the whole thing up, because he's smart, he's brilliant. So when you bless somebody else, you are blessed. Now let me give you two ways that we're gonna ask you to do that. Number one, if I haven't said it once today, I haven't said it 20 times or whatever, be in a life group. The way to get in one is to join a Rooted group. Rooted launches in 2 weeks, February 6th. It's just getting ready to go. Still plenty of time for you to sign up. We've already got, I think Sean told me this week, somewhere around 70 or 80 people are signed up for this round of Rooted. We would love to double or triple that. So if you're not in a life group, sign up for a Rooted group. Meets for a couple of months, and here's the best part. Maybe you're one, somebody who's like, I'm not sure I'd even like a life group. Sounds like another time commitment. I might hate it. Do Rooted. If you hate it, you get a graceful way to bow out at the end, right? You're not committed to anything. But I bet you won't, because you're gonna like it. Because you're gonna get in a circle of people who are gonna love you and pour into you. And when you get that, you hold on to it, okay? So get in a group, check out Rooted. And then here's the other way. On your way in today, I think I have one of these in here. On your way in today, you should have been handed one of these. This is a directory of 58 ways, it says it right on the cover, so it must be true, 58 ways that you can serve right here at First Christian Church. Let me be real transparent. We lost a lot of volunteers during COVID. We had a lot of people who stopped serving and then never stepped back in. And so you know what we have? We have a whole bunch of kids right out those doors who need somebody to teach them about Jesus. We have a whole bunch of people who walk through the doors on Sunday, and man, if there's a smiling face at the door to greet them, it makes a big difference in their day. We got a whole bunch of people who love to come in here and they love to sing songs, but we need singers and people in the band and people on cameras and people running tech and people doing a lot of things to help make it happen. We got a whole bunch of friends that meet down here in Heritage Hall for different classes every week, and we need people to help teach them and lead them and encourage them. We got all kinds of great ministry happening. We got students sitting right here that need leaders to pour into them. We got people who need you. And so I want to encourage you to look at this thing, find something that looks interesting to you, and then go for it. Serve. Use the gifts God has given you. If you see something you like, there's a little form in there that just says serving interest form. Fill this thing out. You can bring it to me. You can turn it in at the Welcome Center. Or today, you have a unique opportunity, and that is in the cafe. You might have noticed it looked a little different this morning. We have some tables set up around the cafe that kind of highlight some of our ministries, and you have an opportunity today to go out in the cafe to meet some ministry leaders, ask questions, find out what it might be like to serve in their ministry. Some of them are even trying to bribe you with food and cookies and stuff like that. So if nothing else, there's good stuff to eat out there. You don't have to sign up for anything, but take a cookie. They're really good. All right? So go out there and check out some tables, ask some questions, and find a place to serve. Because when you do, you will bless somebody. And when you do, you will be blessed. And when you are, your life's gonna change. Because you're gonna see that the kind of community God wants you to have is unlike anything you get anywhere else. And we're made for it. We're made for it. Let me pray for you. God, thanks for this place. Thanks for, not this place, thanks for these people. Thanks for your church. And thanks for the community that you've created, because you know we need it. I pray that anybody who's here today, watching online, wherever, listening later, God, if they're missing that, I pray that they would find it. We don't want it from them, we want it for them. You don't want it from them, you want it for them. You want it for all of us. So God, I pray that you'd help us to find that community so that we can experience the best that you have for us. I'm so, so thankful for Jesus. God, I'm thankful that we get to follow you and be your disciples. And I pray that we would be disciples who make disciples, who teach people to follow you. And God, that we would love well. Thank you for all you've done for us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.